Hero Club presents Los Ingobernables de Tokusatsu.
This is Los Ingobernables de Tokusatsu, episode 45, actually. We're five episodes away, I believe, from our ultimate episode that is episode 50, or actually, this could be 46. I'm all confused today due to the fact that we've had some really hectic things going on in our past week, such as I had to take my father to the ER, Visible Ninja had a midlife crisis, and Project RDM was just Project RDM, which means he wasn't around for any of this. And starting off our show, that pretty much gives you a good guess on who's actually here right now, because let's go over to Midlife Crisis, Visible Ninja.
Good sir. It's a quarter life crisis, but yeah, I kind of agree with you.
Well, with the way you eat cheeseburgers, it's probably your midlife crisis.
Hey, I smoke the Kraken, eat the cheeseburger.
Yep.
Just like the Rob Ford. Exactly.
All right, and then like I said, Project, who wasn't here during all of this incidents that were occurring at the same frickin' time. Sorry, this is not the Visible Ninja Falls Asleep podcast. Thank you, Project.
Unfortunately.
Okay, continue. I'm here.
Okay, so anyways, on this episode of Los Ingobernables de Tokusatsu, the lit list consists of some awesome Tamashii Nation news, some Power Morphicon news, some Gridman news, and then we're going into our discussion about love in Tokusatsu, where that's where we'll be hanging out with Soundout. Since, you know, we had to pre-record a lot of the discussions he thought of in the weeks before he was going to go away for his school trip or his school session thing that has now concluded. So here's the irony about this. Last week I made a joke saying, hey guys, I hope there's more Power Morphicon news coming out. Well, guess what? We got a guest list like 48 hours after I was done editing the last week's episode of the podcast and had it all scheduled up to air just last Saturday. We got that news. So Wave 3 consists of Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, Royce Heron, Miss Appleby, Alien Rangers, Alan Palmer, who was the Black Alien Ranger, Power Rangers Zeos, Nakia Baris, and Catherine Sutherland. That's how they marketed Catherine Sutherland as Zeo, even though she was in MMPR. Hillary Shepherd, Divatox, Saturday Only, Justin Nimoy Zane from In Space, Rhett Fisher, Titanium Ranger, Time Force, Vernon Wells Rancic, Tone Rodriguez, the concept designer, Power Rangers Wild Forces, Philip Jean-Marie, which is Max Cooper, the Blue Ranger, Jack Guzman, Danny Delgado, the Black Ranger, Allison Kipperman, the Yellow Ranger, and from Bandai America / Japan, toy designer Toyoshi Nonaka, and from Boom Studios, Scott Shaw, one of their artists. So, all right, guys, quick rundown. What's your thoughts on the recent guest? I'll go to Project first, since he's actually attending the convention.
I did?
You're attending the convention.
No, I am? Attended.
You're gonna. Just your thoughts.
Well, that's good they have more guests, although I'm still kind of dreading that the fact that they might not actually have any Tokusatsu actors show up.
Yeah, I'm wondering, are we getting Sentai actors? Like, I'm getting very, 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 very skittish. I'm like, where's my Sentai? Where's my Zhu Rangers?
Where's my Dai Rangers? If I don't see one, I'm just going to call it now. I'm not going. Not even one. I just need one, and it'll guarantee me going. But if no one shows up, I am not going.
Next thing, they announce the entire Jew Ranger cast, including Burai.
Well, then I guess I'm getting the VIP one to go. Well, it's a good list, but because I don't even know Wave 1 and 2. I never actually read who's there, so I have to check that out. But I don't know. Hey, they're getting more people, which is good.
I mean, you're still probably going to go at least a day if we get those press badges, but nevertheless. Visible Ninja, your thoughts on the list?
Okay, again, pretty solid. I mean, there's some people you'd expect to come, like I know Catherine Sutherland and Nakia, you know, do the concert quite often, so it's no surprise seeing them there, as well as some other ones. It's good to have, you know, Justin Nemo, and as well as Danny and Max, always good to see those guys. The interesting ones, obviously, is that Vernon Wells is coming back since he's great, and I hope to hear him berate Darkon again. So that's gonna be awesome.
Yeah, that was a thing that happened, didn't it?
Yes, and I can't wait to hopefully hear it happen again and 10 times as vulgar, possibly involving a pipe to the chest and a quip about letting off some steam.
Yeah, but that's how I did the joke to him. I hit him with that line. I got him good on that one.
But yeah, otherwise, seeing actually somebody from actual Plex who's worked on the toys both for BOJ and BOA is actually going to be kind of interesting, hearing kind of his kind of input on the toys, both in Japan and over here, like the design process and etc. That's actually going to be pretty interesting.
All right, then, we'll move on to our next piece of news, which is actually the Power Rangers Shattered Grid stuff. All right, last week we got confirmation that the Ranger Slayer is not the name of the actual new Megazord. The Ranger Slayer is the new actual Ranger being debuted in the comic, and the Megazord itself is called the Gravezord, since it is using scraps of previously seen Megazords from Seasons 1 through 2. And one thing about Shattered Grid is they actually made a live-action prelude short, which features Jason David Frank dressed up as Drakkon and, you know, ordering his Ranger sentries to attack the multiverse. It was actually produced by Kyle Higgins and also did feature some Rangers coming back to reprise their roles for ADR scenes. And that was practically about it. The only real nominal person to actually on-screen appear is JDF, as well as having music contributed by Juan Rasserman. Did anyone here actually see it, and what were their thoughts on the
production? I do admit, it is JDF, so, you know, people are going to love it or hate it on that fact alone, depending how you feel about the man himself. But in all, like, it was a pretty good teaser, you know, seeing, you know, real, you know, IRL JDF in a Drakkon suit. It was actually kind of cool. And the fact they actually got back some actors to do ADR stuff, like we know Amy Jo actually did do some ADR stuff for Kimberly, so that's actually kind of cool, too. And, like, it's interesting that, like so much hype is going into, like, a comic event, which is, I guess it kind of goes to show how big of a deal the Boom Studios comics are to the greater, I guess you could say, Power Rangers verse now.
I wouldn't say it's not just that. I think it's the fact that Boom Studios finally found something where they can actually try to market themselves, since not many people even knew they existed. Like, I feel like they're so niche that they're like, oh shit, we finally found our footing, you know, coattailing off of Power Rangers, so let's put more money and effort into
promoting
this. Well,
yeah, but like I said, that's a smart idea, because by all accounts, it is paying off, so... Which is,
yeah, I mean, it's not like Valiant and them doing their weird movies things.
Yeah, like as much as I like Valiant, yeah, it's true. But like I said, it's kind of, you know, nice to see I don't want to use an example of like the Star Wars like expanded universe, but that's kind of what the comic stuff kind of feels like for me for Power Rangers. It's kind
of
like...
Well, it is, because don't forget the
comics. Well, I know, but it's
the comics
it's like
are trying to...
Stuff
well, no. No, think about it, because the comics are trying to insinuate that freaking Zack and Trini were a couple when it was Billy and Trini that were a couple.
Well,
even David Yost said, I thought that was a ship.
I thought that was being shit with Twee, but yeah. And early in season one, yeah, you really see it, but... Like it really is kind of going into the whole EU kind of thing, which is pretty cool, because it can really help you flesh out your universe, and that's definitely what the comics have been doing. Not to mention, you know, creating their own kind of legacy, I guess you could say, you know, pun intended, with Drakkon and now Ranger Slayer, who's, you know, actually Kimberly, but hey, whatever.
Well, you know, it's great how we finally are getting more non-Power Rangers is through an event where he's going to be killing other seasons that we wanted to be seen featured in the comics more than actual MMPR.
I'm not
talking about what fans want, because I really care less what majority of the fans think with
well
SPD
no I'm just saying because they do factor into Shattered Grid, like RPM and SPD and stuff, but yeah.
All right,
no,
Brandon, you got a quick rundown on seeing the production of the video?
I think it's neat, because they're making this comic a big deal. I actually subscribe to the Boom Studios comic, because I get it every... Is it a bi-weekly or a monthly title? I forgot. But my comic book store has me on a pull list, so basically every time it comes out, I get it. I actually requested for two of the variants, so it's going to be interesting to see what I get.
All right, then. We'll move on to our figure news before we go to our cap-off of the news. All right, so... First off, we have from P-Bandai, most of these I think are all P-Bandai items, we have Kamen Rider Kronos Chronicle Gamer, which is set to release in August for 6,480 yen. It will actually feature the Buggle Driver and Gamer Driver, so he can actually be optionally designed to be either, you know, Masamune Don or actually Taiga for, you know, your figure arts recreation purposes. And honestly, that's all he comes with for his pieces, even though there was a version of Chrono seen earlier with the actual sword and shield of Gemu Deus. It seems that the figure will no longer come with that, and they're probably going to reissue him at a later date with those accessories, I'm guessing.
Oh, yeah, hashtag, you know, inevitable repaint as Gemu Deus Chronos.
The next exclusive is obviously Kamen Rider Grease from Kamen Rider Build. Now, everyone knows by now that that is actually Koei Takeda, who was previously Kiva's Otoya, and this figure is going to feature the Twin Breaker as well as a Phoenix full bottle and a robot full bottle that he can insert into the Twin Breaker, or he can use his, you know, grease glass jelly, whatever you would say.
Yeah,
it's also going to be released this August, and it's going to be priced at 6,264 yen. The next exclusive, I believe, is also another August release. Most of these are all August, by the way. It's S.H.Figuarts Pandan from the original Ultra 7. It's also coined as the biggest invasion in history set due to the fact that it was technically, I think, the two-parter was referred to as the biggest invasion in Earth's history. This Pandan features the ability to become reconstructed Pandan when it had its left arm and right leg amputated by Seven, and then they gave it, you know, new robotic limbs. It also features the ability to have its head cut off. There are no other additional accessories for it outside of optional hands and, like I said, the dismembered limbs. And it's going to be priced at 8,100 yen. The final, I think, August exclusive that we know of thus far is actually SH Monster Arts Mechagodzilla Final Battle version. This is actually the MF S3 Kiru Mechagodzilla, so this is a, you know, almost like their premium colors editions for the Monster Arts. This is the updated awesome reissue that gives it everything the fans wanted the first time. What I mean by that is you get the original Kiru with all of its weapons packs, like the, what do you call it, the Mazer Beam Saber on its right arm, you know, the dual-mounted pistols with the little blade inside. You get the actual Thruster Missile Pack, as well as the never-before-released Absolute Zero effect set to go with your Absolute Zero chest piece cannon. And in addition, it gives you optional parts to display it as the damage final battle scene, where it has a destroyed chest core, a severed right arm, as well as the optional head from the original run. Since this badass is going to be a P-Bandai exclusive due to the fact that the original version didn't sell too well because it didn't have any of these additional accessories fans solely wanted, it's going to be selling for 12,960 yen. Alright, whoever wants to go first about these P-Bandai exclusives being sold in August? Visible Ninja, I'm guessing I'm going to go with you first, since you're the one who's probably more animated about these.
All right, figures. Okay. I'll actually start off with our boy Chronos. Like I said, yeah, he was shown with the shield and sword, but that's, again, they're saving that for the inevitable, you know, Gemma Deus Chronos repaint. So, you know, hashtag not surprised. Grease actually does look pretty good for, you know, fig art, so cool. But yeah, the Kiru is probably what I could talk about most, because it does include a lot of what was released. Like, it did have the railgun on the side and the booster armor. The inclusion, though, of the effect part for the Absolute Zero Cannon is pretty cool, as well as, you know, the optional damaged head and right arm and core, which is kind of cool. Sad those didn't come with the original version. Yeah, but then again, I'm one of those guys of, like, I still have the original version, so I won't pick this up, but it's... You know, for people who don't already have it and definitely wouldn't mind picking it up, like, this is definitely the way to go.
I'm going to be honest with you. This is the actual real reason I never bought the original Kiru version. Oh, yeah. And I bought the heavy armored edition for Tokyo SOS.
Mm-hmm. Which I, funnily enough, still need. But anyways.
Like, the only difference is a few color apps and the cooler
weapons attachments. Yeah, it has the different booster pack and it has the drill hand, but... Oh, and the triple mazer in the chest instead of the Absolute Zero Cannon, but... Yeah, but still, anyways. Like I said, it's a good release for people who don't already have Kiru, like myself, and I guess like you, even though it's a slightly different version, but... Still, yeah, that absolute zero cannon effect is damn sexy, though.
All right, Project, your thoughts on the Figuarts?
Interesting. I might buy one, but let's say I gotta save my money.
Yeah, out of all these things, I'm gonna say this right now. I'm very happy about the at least Mechagodzilla one, because I can always get it when it releases in North America, and it possibly gets, you know, an Amazon discount sale. As for Pandon, that's the one that's kind of an FU, but here's hoping that we get King Pandon, which is the modern day Heisei incarnation of Pandon, where his two heads, instead of being like coming out of the neck on one of the opposite sides, it actually has two, you know, Cerberian, like, you know, Draco heads. You know, it's a dual head sticking out of its upper torso, you know what I'm saying, like a Ghidra-esque, mm-hmm. like multi-head, rather than being two heads on one neck. So I'm hoping that we'll get a King Pandon in the future. I still would like to have a, you know, a Showa Pandon, especially because I do like Ultra 7. Ultra 7 is one of my first, you know, incarnations of the Ultra series that I've ever seen, yada, yada, yada. As for Grease and, you know, Kronos, if I had to choose between the either or, I'd probably just go with Kronos, because I'm still more of a fan of Exe than I am Build. And, Kira. No, I'll get it. Like I said, I'll get it. And then we go on to our last bit of news, I believe. This is the last bit of news, since we're not going to talk about Telebikoon scans this time around. Since they mostly talk about toy scans, we've already talked about. And when I mean, like, toy scans, I mean, like, they're just introducing the mechas and, you know, full bottles and forms that we've already seen due to previous toy catalogs. So the last bit of news is that Baby Don Don, the first minute, you know, teaser trailer for SSSS.Gridman, the animated series from Studio Trigger. And honestly, I don't know what I can really say about this trailer. Visible Ninja, maybe you can give us a good rundown.
Well, there's not a whole lot to the trailer. We're introduced to our various human characters, including our kind of main pro tag, essentially. And it basically has, like, I think a grand total of, like, 3 seconds of actual Gridman in it.
Yeah, there's so 3 seconds of Gridman and like 2 seconds of a kaiju forming in the real world.
Yeah, and the rest of it is just kind of focusing on these are the characters that we'll mostly be following for the series, most likely. So like there wasn't a whole lot to it. Like, I am still like definitely looking forward to seeing the series, but like I wasn't expecting Gridman to be in it like a whole lot, but yeah, it's just kind of like, it's becoming what I expected it to be, which is, you know, more in line with what anime is these days, and focusing a little less on, let's just say, giant monster spectacle. But, hey, I guess we'll have to wait to see when it actually comes out,
though. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I expected after the first teaser trailer, which was just, you know, the poster trailer, and it showing the original Gridman, then leading into, like, you know what I'm saying, like, the old, when it did the old original Shotoku, and then it went to the anime, like, poster of him just standing in the city, like, I actually expected following that, like, the next preview trailer, or the first full-length trailer, which was technically this, I was expecting us to actually hear the original theme song yet again, and more Gridman. I was expecting more, you know, Gridman action rather than what we got in this trailer, which was, here's your cast, and here's their plucky-go-lucky day, until shit happens and we meet Gridman.
Until they found the blue card and everything changed.
Wrong anime franchise.
I know. But yeah, it's... we'll have to see, because, like I said, it is being done by Studio Trigger, so it will look nice, you know, either way.
Yeah, but all right. Way, yeah. Project, do you have anything to say about the Gridman trailer, or have you not watched it yet?
I've seen it. It looks cool.
So pretty much, yeah, like we said, it's a little lackluster, but it leaves for the possibility of...
It's a teaser, really.
I know. Like that's the thing, though. A lot other previews have done more than this has. That's the only thing that I felt was disappointing. Other previews have been a little bit more ambiguous in their first 60 seconds, I guess. All right, it's time for another discussion here on Los Ingobernables de Tokusatsu, and we're going to be joined yet again by Visible Ninja this week. And in our discussion, we're going to be talking about Love and Tokusatsu and the ships that didn't sail. Pretty much, when it comes to Tokusatsu, there's either defined relationships, whether it be with villains or your heroes, or heroes with your villains, and then there's some where they just instigate that the relationship is there, but never really touch upon it. They, like, poke at it, they say it's kind of there, but they never execute it, even in the finale. So, the funny thing is when it comes to Love and Tokusatsu, it ranges from your Daikaiju films, which are usually a little bit more predestined to actually for them to get together. You have your, you know, your Rider series where it's sometimes never going to happen, especially in your Showa era. Your Heisei era, it might actually happen. And then you have Sentai, where it's a freaking drama and a half. Metal Heroes, they fall under that category too at times. Garo does. Ultraman does.
Garo does a lot.
There's a lot of crazy love stories going on in Tokusatsu. It just really is hard to follow through with it. So
why is it so hard to follow through with it?
Like I said, because the writers and the producers, I think, are sometimes scared. They're scared of, one, executing the wrong relationship if they're actually shipping a character with more than one love interest. They're afraid to execute which one they want to choose because of the fan backlash. Two, they're also afraid to execute on, you know, relationships and love due to supposedly how the actual, like, their version of the FCC will react towards how they seek to execute it, you know? Because allegedly, like, you can't have certain types of relationships on screen for whatever your normal age audience is or a time of day. It's almost like how we have certain things that you can and cannot do. Like, think about back in the 50s, if you were married in, like, you know, 50s and even before that, couples were in two separate beds. It's like something like that where, like, you know, in certain shows, you either can't show them actually kissing, and if they do kiss, it has to be, like, a crappy peck, or, like, a light has to shine through their lips to, like, you know, lens flare and blind you. So from what I understand, it all deals with the time of day, the type of bylaws, and exactly what's going on.
That kind of law actually goes on to V-cinemas, too, because apparently, like, the Zangetsu Gaiden was supposed to have a bed scene, but they got told that they couldn't do it.
Oh, God, yeah. I think it happened with Double 2 with Sayako and the Weather Dopant. Similar thing happened.
Yeah.
Because I know in one of the, like, the web movies, they showed some deleted scenes from the show, and that was actually one of them. They didn't say why it was cut. It just was cut. But
it's funny because Nazca ass was okay, but not anybody.
Oh, yeah. Man ass is totally fine. But, you know, seeing a man kiss a woman, like, shit. Shit, man. That's real.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Is, like, supposedly kissing is, like, a really big deal. It's something about the culture. It's something about the privacy of a couple. They think that if you're kissing in public, then that has to be your actual wife. Like, if you're kissing a normal, like, girl makeout, they think it's obscenely disgusting. Unless they're like, oh, it's your wife? Okay. And, like, even then, they expect you to only kiss her on, like, the forehead or the cheek. You can't actually, like, lip lock her.
Oh, I've seen enough, you know, shoujo romantic comedies to know that that's 100% true.
It's funny, because the only time I've actually seen, like, lip lock with a couple in any toku was the live-action Devilman.
It always comes back to Devilman.
It always comes back to Devilman, but seriously, like, it was a Toei-produced movie, so it's relevant.
Well,
and
oh,
it is,
yeah.
Technically a toku.
True. The hardcore lip locks that I've ever seen, the ones that are, like, the really hardcore ones are, like, in freaking Invasion of the Astro Monster, where freaking Nick Adams is making out with Kimi Mizuno, you know? Like, that's the closest I've ever seen, like, actual kissing, I think, even in toku, because when you watch, like, what is it, the marriage scene sometimes in Kamen Rider, they do the head thing where you see them make the look of the kiss, but you know for a fact they're just angling their heads to look like they're doing it, you know?
Yeah.
So, like, even then, like, they don't go all the way. I think, what was it? I think they got away with it with the Tiga Final Odyssey movie, though, right, Metal? Did they chip us out of that?
Actually, no, yeah, we do see Daigo and Reina kiss, but I think it's after they're married. So technically, it doesn't count.
So technically, it doesn't count.
Well, yeah, because apparently, you know, husband-wife is fine, but yeah, because I think it was just, like just after they, like, just as they got married, so I guess it wouldn't count for our purposes.
Yeah, I guess, like, during the actual wedding ceremony, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
But like, did they actually show the lip lock on screen? Because, like, I remember, what was it, in Kiva, they didn't even show Megumi actually, like, kiss him, because I think right when they're about to kiss,
dumb shithead
Kamen Rider Grease shows up.
Papa, the new Fangires are attacking! Please come help me! And I don't know why I look like Grandpa for some reason.
Because his actual father isn't really... Yeah, it's not. His father isn't actually Wataru. His father is Grease!
Ah.
Who is the other who is the bastard son of Otoya?
It could work, weirdly enough. Weirdly enough, that could actually work. Like, timeline-wise, that could work, which is sad. Headcanon.
So now, since we're at this point where we've rambled on about the bylaws of love and tokusatsu, how about we talk about actual couples, whether they be the good guys with the good guys, bad guys with the bad guys,
oh, yeah.
Good with the bad.
Zonin, Red Racer.
Yeah. Well, there's a few other ones where I think there's been a few shippings between the villains and the heroes.
What is it? What's his name?
What was the show?
Kyoryu Blue and Candelia.
Yeah, Kyoryu Blue and Candelia.
They were shipping there.
They were shipping there.
You know, when people were joking that his descendant in 100 years after is going to be half Day Boss, but it's actually descended from his niece, not him, even though he looks like, you know, the original Blue, which doesn't make sense because it's descended from his niece, not him, but whatever. I'm not going to get into identical, you know, descendants bullshit, but...
Hey, man, think about it. It gets weirder and weirder every day. Every day. So,
well, hey, at least black and gold are gay in 100 years after. So there's always that.
I think that's just a fan speculation.
Yeah, that's just fan. That's just fan head canon. But yeah. Oh, God. Like, they're I'm just trying to think.
Because like, here's the funny thing. When I think, since I haven't seen all of the old, like, you know, Sentai series, like all the way up to, I think, like, Live Man to like the Five Man area, like even before that, like I think one of the few villainous couples that I can think of, like right from the get go, like the first actual villainous couples is supposed to be Griffissa and Lamy, followed by Boldaunt and his wife in O-Ranger, as well as, you know, King Bakid and his wife are like the only few villain, like those are the ones where they're actual couples.
You mean his cousin?
Sound out. This is royalty bylaws in Japan, so it makes sense. You know, because in Japan you're allowed to marry, you can marry your first cousin.
Yeah.
Yeah, guys. So if you want to be literally Japan is just, you know, the Pacific version of Alabama.
Oh yeah.
And then you have the ninja, like Metal said, which features Takaharu just getting a chick pregnant.
Well, no, that chick we assume is actually Shishiro Yamamoto's character that showed up a few, you know, halfway through the show.
Yeah. Plus the fact that Yakumo wants to bang Katsumi, so.
Yeah.
First cousins, you know, wanting to bang, you know, it's Japan,
that's a thing.
So.
That's an actual story. That's a thing. That's another reason why Ninja's weird. Ninja's weird.
Oh, God. Oh, but then there's the granddaddy of them all, the double love triangle from Jetman, so.
How is it a double love triangle?
Well, because they both involve Ryo.
Oh, yeah, because he doesn't like white blonde.
And Rei, who's his fiance, and, you know, Super Bender, along with, you know, Kaori and Guy, so.
And then you throw in the weird little, you know, side story
Raida likes Kaori too. and then everyone Blue Swallow likes dies. There's that too.
It's like, when you think about it, Jetman is one of the ones where it's the great ship war. It is truly the great, like, there's probably shipping and actual couples way before that series, but it is the one that people remember as the greatest love tango ever. Because
they even say, like it took a lot of notes from a lot of the dramas at the time, like the daytime dramas, you know, with love triangles and such like that, you know, the whole thing. And then, you know, the bad boy eventually winning, you know, little rich miss over, but then it not really working out in the end. That kind of stuff is apparently another trope from the time.
Yeah,
and then
one
of them being a smoking, drinking, gambling robot is apparently also another trope, which is kind of weird.
Yeah, who would have expected a robot being a part of a love triangle? Anyone? Nobody?
I did.
Well,
That's just because I watch some weird shit.
That's just because I watch weird shit. No, because, like, that's the thing. It's like, when it comes to Sentai is known to, I think, do a lot more better shipping, even when they don't mean to do it.
Well, Ryder is definitely guilty of shipping either intentionally or unintentionally. You know what I mean? Like, because I guess that would fall under ships that didn't sail, because more often than not with Ryder, it's the that didn't sail variety.
Yeah, because, like, that's the thing. Like, when you get actual relationships, you see a lot of actual relationships in Sentai, and then I would say in the Heisei era, you've gotten some for Rider. But with Sentai, they've kept usually actual thing going with ships. In Metal Hero, there were also ships, but they didn't really do anything with them. Like, what is it? Gavin and his assistant, she had a crush on him, so did her sister. Scheider, Mimi allegedly was in love with Scheider, but never actually got with him. There's the story of, what is it?
Annie and,
I'm trying to remember. And it's the series with Time Red and Time Pink, where they were the child versions of them. Oh god, why can't I think of them? I think it was also Spielbahn yet again. Where in Spielbahn, he was in love with his assistant, and his sister even knew that. And his sister was turned into the bad guy, and then they rescued the bad guy, and then I think they actually were able to get together in the end. Mm. I haven't finished Spielbahn. I'm just saying. I just know Spielbahn because of the filmography of Time Red and Time Pink. Let's talk about a ship that didn't sail, because that was some convoluted bullshit.
It did sail, but then it was retconned out of existence, maybe?
And then it happened again in Power Rangers.
Yeah, except for they actually had resolution that time, so it was a bit better.
Like, at least
until the time reset with Hyperforce.
Yeah, no, because here's the thing. Time was completely reset with Time Rangers. So, like, right when he's like, I love you, and she's like, I love you, erased. But then, like, Domon, you know, the love story with him is probably one of the more funniest ones. Because for half of his story with him falling in love with the photographer is that she's in love with ISA.
Oh, yeah, well, I admit, like I said, when we looked at Time Ranger on my Ninja Talks Live Toku, shameless plug, that I liked Honomi and Domon's kind of plot line because it was kind of used very sparingly. Like, it was only, like, every so often, which I guess you can kind of say made you more invested because you didn't see it all the time. Plus, because, you know, it wasn't going to end very well, pretty much. But, you know, it was nice to see them, you know, finally kind of get together at the end. And him, obviously, you know, bang her because, you know, she's pregnant, you know, in the epilogue. And then, obviously, Time Ranger, he finally finds out that he had a kid. But he should be not existing, but he is existing. And the kid should not be existing, but he is. I just fried my brain, but whatever.
Yeah, I mean, there's a few other relationships that are kind of weird in Toku, like the one in Gingaman, where it's heavily stated that Saya has a huge crush on Ryuga, who is, you know, freaking... No, it's Hyuga, I think. Is it Hyuga?
Yeah, Hyuga.
Hyuga. Hyuga, who is Bull Black. And, like, it's kind of those ones where he's kind of dumb to the scenario. Like, it seems like he kind of knows she's in love with him, but he doesn't let it go really any further than it is throughout the run of the series. Like, he never, like, shows any reciprocation towards her advances. He's just like, oh, Saya, you're my friend. Like that is probably the funniest thing. He friend zones his love interest that is expected to be his wife, I guess, by the time the series ends. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like how in a lot of the 90s tokus, there was, like, a lot of weird shenanigans where either the woman was in love with one of the, either a red senshi or one of the main senshi, but the other senshi was like, nah, we're just co-workers. We're just colleagues. Back up, bitch.
Oh, God, yeah.
You know what's another great ship?
Which one?
Mega Pink with anything that walks.
Oh, God, yeah.
Thought be gone.
Yeah, exactly. Because, yeah, she was pretty thoughtish.
I mean, the first question when Mega Silver showed up on her mind was, how old are you? Not worried about who he was, where he came from.
He's like, I want me some of that.
Yeah, and then she only got worse.
Oh, God.
She groped her friend one time just for fun. She really liked milking a cow. She really implied a lot of things.
Ooh.
She always wore a bikini and always would dip down in front of any guy that walked by.
It's not like these are bad things, but Still. Yeah.
Miku with anyone that walked is the only, like, the only non-successful successful ship in Sentai.
Oh, and let's not forget about, you know, one of the greatest of all time. Oh, you know, Chifu.
Chifu. Yeah, he friend-zoned her. He friend-zoned her so hard until the end, it wasn't even funny. With freaking Boken Pink. Boken Pink is deeply in love with Boken Red. Boken Red's just, you know, like, what?
Oh, you're coming with me, Sakura. You two also have a love for adventure, and she's like, you're goddamn it.
Yeah, I love that. I love how, like, she gets away. Like, what is it? The professor's like, where'd Sakura go? And the others are like, like, all three other, three or four Boken dudes are just like, I know where she is.
Fans.
And then there's that weird thing where early on, was it Natsuki? It has, like, a Natsuki. Weird... Yeah, Natsuki, like, in a sense, is supposed to be shipped with Boken Black because he's the one who found her. But then, like, in early episodes, like, after, like, the one episode where she really hates Boken Blue, she kind of pals around with him quite often.
Ultimately, they kind of don't really ship Natsuki with anybody.
Like, they only ship her, like, loosely with Boken
Black.
Like,
a little bit with... a little bit with Matsumi, but that's only because they're kind of... have this kind of bond because they were, like, you know... partners, and because he rescued her and everything, but it doesn't really go anywhere beyond that. So
yeah, like, when it comes to actual couples in Sentai, I would say, like, you know, you have your White Swan with Red Hawk, you have the actual villains in some of the Sentais, you have Magi Blue and Magi Shine.
I was just gonna say, yeah.
There was actually, you know, supposed to be Hurricane Blue and the Go Rider Blue, because they copied that.
Kuwaga Rider. Yeah, Kuwaga Rider.
That was a relationship. There's the one relationship where even they were trying to get married in a movie, and that couldn't even happen. Deca Pink and Deca Yellow. I mean, Deca Pink and that'd be a great marriage. Deca Pink, Deca Pink and Deca Green.
Well, they did. Okay. They tried first, it, you know, got interrupted by a certain, you know, space sheriff. Tried again and got interrupted again, so, yeah.
Yeah. It's great, isn't it? Isn't it great how many times they get...
You know what is the best Power Rangers relationship ever? Haley and Calvin. They're so good together, it's like they aren't actually a couple.
Wait, who?
Oh, God. Ninja Steel, Yellow and White.
Oh my god, allegedly they are a couple, but they don't do couple stuff. Yeah, I know.
They say they're a couple, but they barely spend time with each other.
No, they do, and it's usually just them holding hands and going, hey, I'll see you later. Alright.
Like, la, seriously? La, la. Seriously, Calvin would be dating Sarah more than he would be Haley.
And we all know he wants
You
Sarah.
You know what's funny, too? Because isn't there a tweet on her wall going, we hang out more in real life than him and his actual girlfriend on the show. His girlfriend in show hangs out with him.
Yep. Because they're BFFs and whatever.
And My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, yada, yada, yada. Literally, because don't forget, she, Christiane's one true dream is to be a unicorn.
Insert crude humor about horns here, but yes. Oh, God. And if we're working back from that, then, God, I guess we'll have to talk about Tyler and Shelby, since that was also a thing.
Only because Daigo and Amy were a thing.
But they arguably did it a little better in Dino Charge, because it was set up a bit more.
Like, set up at all.
It was foreshadowed. It was foreshadowed a bit more than it just coming the hell out of nowhere during, like, the finale.
No, everyone keeps saying it came out of nowhere in the finale. It was still foreshadowed throughout the fact that Yaoi's character existed.
For the record, what's it called? It's already foreshadowed because she was the first one to actually help him.
Yeah, that too.
The fact that she was the first one to actually help him become a...
Because that was the thing. Like, it was already foreshadowed that they got along together because she was the first one to want to work with him. It was foreshadowed again as soon as Yaoi showed up and was like, I have a crush on Daigo. And she's like,
Best face. Best jealous face.
She got so jealous that freaking Uchi, Mr. freaking not so obvious idiot guy from the past, is like, hey, you like King, don't you? She was like, what you say to me? Yeah. You're in love
with him. Well, okay, I have to concede that.
Well, that was the thing. It was like a one-sided ship, and then suddenly Daigo was like super into her all of a sudden.
Let's talk about the greatest relationship that me and Invisible Ninja stumbled upon rewatching Kamen Rider Black.
Yeah.
How his adopted sister was in love with him.
Hey,
it's no weirder than The Flash.
Well, no, it's just as weird as The Flash.
Well, yeah, it's not really, because, you know, technically they're not related, even though he kind of considers her like a sister to him, since they kind of grew up together. But
I mean, it is the greatest episode ever.
It's different than Devilman.
Like, it's probably one of the greatest episodes ever, though, because, like, Black is smitten with a monster that's using, like, a love spell. As he goes to rush out, like, to save this woman who's really the monster, his sister's like, oh, no. Oh no, that's actually the monster. I gotta go warn him. As she's running to go chase after Kotaro, Battlehopper shows up and is like, my queen, I will show you the way. And I was like, oh shit.
Get on, bitch.
And that's
Battlehopper's not as cool as Zaruba.
I know, but no. Battlehopper was the initiative for Zaruba. Think about it. Keitai Amamiya that's worked true. On Black RX with Shinomori. I'm like, obviously.
Shit, wow.
Think about it. Zaruba was first a ring. Now he's a motorcycle.
See?
Revelations.
Do you want to know the revelations?
I swear to God, Zac Efron, shut the fuck up. I'm making that a t-shirt now, patent pending. David Zac Efron, shut the fuck up.
You know why he's so salty? Because, you know, he wants to break out in song and dance, but he can't dance, so...
Hey, there's actually a song about I don't dance.
Well, it's not he don't, it's just he can't.
You don't need to have feet to dance.
Yeah, tell that to Broadway.
I know, they're so Yo! Damn it, I should fucking tweet at Broadway, you discriminatory bastards. Watch, that's how Hero Club gets famous. We just talk about how they don't let any cripples in Broadway.
And then they let you in.
I'd be like, shit, we're good.
I don't know.
No, when my luck sound out, I get on the King Kong stage play, and I'm like the first loser to get eaten by him, like, you fuckers.
Oh, does the King Kong stage play go like this? Kong is the one to eat us all.
You know there's going to be a piece calling King Kong the eighth wonder of the world. You know for a fact there's going to be an entire song about
King
the eighth
Kong,
wonder.
The eighth. Wonder of the world, he's here today, King Kong.
Kong breaks out the song.
The eighth wonder of the world.
Baby Don Don.
Okay, so, let's how about we actually talk
what
about...
What do we do? I do not know.
Okay, how about we talk about the actual relationships in Kamen Rider in the modern era that actually happened, since there's only like one.
Let's 44. Bring out Wheelchair's favorite. One, of course, being, you know, Wizard and Kiyomi.
No, I was going to say, it's actually called Shinosuke and, you know.
Mayonnaise.
Oh, you mean the only successful.
The actual successful one, yeah. The actual successful one. The one that actually put the ring
Kiriko.
On it. Yeah, Kiriko.
Yeah.
That's like the
don't
only...
forget Excellent, you know, Squawking Dolphin.
But that's a terrible relationship, because it was weird. Always. Entirely.
And he turned down, you know, Reporter Chick. And later Science Chick, and you know what, she's been in a lot of shit since then, but yeah.
Like, that's the thing about, like, when it comes to relationships in Rider, like, we have, what is it, Meteor and Goth Girl. We also have, you know, modern day Ixa with Megumi. And it seems like if you're a secondary Rider, you get laid. If you're the main Rider, not so much.
Unless you're Drive.
Drive is like one of the first few people to get out of that area. He's like, no, I am putting a ring on this chick. No, you're not. Yes, I am.
And then he put a baby in her.
Yep.
Hey, man, he sent a ring through time to give her a ring. So, yeah, that's right. He did it. He was in the past, left the ring, buried it, she found it, boom.
Well, that's the thing that I find funny, though, is they even try to repeat that step again with freaking Ghost and, you know, Science Girl. But then they kind of, like, just dropped the ball where it was, like in the Pac-Man X-Aid movie, like, if she, that's my entire life right there. And we're like, and then you don't actually tell her that she matters to you? What a loser, Ghost. You dropped the
which
ball.
Which is sad, because we know for a fact they get together because we meet their son in the very last episode.
I know. It's allegedly that it's their son.
You know, that's another great ship in Kamen Rider.
Kuga and, what's her face?
And Kuruto and his keyboard.
That too.
Ah!
I mean,
imagine
he died over that keyboard. He literally died over that keyboard.
Several times.
And one of them was the best one ever, you know, when he actually just passes out on the board.
See, actually, the board stabbed him in cold blood.
I was getting tired of him pounding enter. Hey, man, I prefer to pound escape.
Oh, God, and speaking of XA, let's not forget, you know, sniping Nico. So, you know, because, you know, he's got to have his underage tail, even though she's supposed to be 18, but the actress is like 14. But yeah, whatever.
I think she's like 16, isn't she?
I don't know. I'd have to look it up.
Google.
To Google, which I can't do right now because I'm waiting for a stream to start.
Google.
And then there's Love
Wait,
Luka
is it actually going to be a stream? Who knows? Yeah, oh yeah, Love Luka with everyone. But then again, I think he's roofing people.
I think it's pretty obvious that, yeah, that's what he's doing.
The Bill Cosby.
Actually, here's the thing. How about this? There's a relationship we're forgetting about. Our favorite Caucasian character in Kamen Rider gets a woman in the end. John. He gets with the doctor.
Oh, yeah.
The single cougarous doctor. Yeah, that cougarous doctor in Kuga.
Our boy, Jean-Paul Sorel.
Let's also speak about one of the greatest, you know, relationships in Kamen Rider that never actually happened because she was a girl crushing over a man like, you know, 10 years older than her. Mana and Agito. The most adorable thing ever, where Mana's like, I love you, Agito. And Soichi's like, yeah, Mana, I'm too old for you, but I still love you.
It's like, I care for you, Mana-chan, as a good friend. Mana's like, screw you, I'm going to burn out my psychic powers and be useless. Okay.
Yeah, that's kind of what happened. Like she was so devoted to him. Like, she had, like, new type love syndrome on him. She was like, I sense Agito seed. I will use my psychic powers for him. And he's like, okay, fine.
And I'll revive Gills after he's killed, but it'll burn out my powers. Woo.
In the end, Mana didn't get anything, but she got a whole lot of time. Time to make some coffee.
Time to have the best ass in Japan, 2007?
Only 2007?
No, she had like 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
I can't think of other relationships in Tokusatsu. Like there's Garo and oh god, what's her name?
Yeah, Karu.
There was Zero and his dead. There was Zero and his dead fiance. There was Jobby and Garo. Then there was Jobby and Dan. But Dan was more one sided. I feel like. Does anyone have any other relationships that we should be talking about?
Marvelous and Joe.
Oh yeah.
They devoted a whole movie to that.
The end in decade.
Oh, and I guess Tsukasa and Daiki, you know, by that same.
Yeah,
movie,
yeah, and then so it was a love triangle because there was decade in Natsumi, and then there was Daiki and oh my god, and Decade didn't want either of them.
He just wanted to travel the world and destroy.
What else? Like, I'm trying to think. There's other relationships. Genki. What?
Melee and Ryo.
Oh yeah, Melee and Ryo. Yeah, oh, yeah. And that's another relationship there that we're forgetting.
Melee and the Fly.
No. Not really.
Well, the fly. Is it Sosuke and Mio?
Oh yeah, Mew. When Mew has like this.
Mew has
a crush on Sosuke, but it's only because she likes hopeless people.
Oh,
which is kind of messed up, but.
Toei and Bandai.
That's the worst marriage ever. How dare you? That's the marriage that haunts us all. I mean, think about it. It's the one that ruins our wallets on a weekly basis or monthly basis.
Yeah, monthly basis.
If we lived in Japan, it'd be weekly.
You know it.
You know, it's just the nature of things.
The nature of the beast, man.
Yeah, I just realized, though, like, because of, like, how we talked about at the beginning of the episode, because of the laws and stuff in Japan, like, we don't really ever get any execution to these relationships, and it's kind of stupid. Like, especially when they're so dead set with, you know, couple of A and B, and they don't have, like, you know, a triangle. So it's like, when they have triangles, they don't even do anything. They just make it really oblivious at times. Because think of, like, this is the one that me and Metal were talking about a couple of nights ago. Was, look at Shinkenger. They were shipping everyone with everything. Like, they shipped Ryunosuke with Mako, but it was one-sided. They shipped Chiaki with Kota,
Takeru and Mako.
And then it was Mako and Takeru and Kotaha with Takeru, but and then there was Genta with Takeru,
Ryunosuke with Takeru.
Yeah, Ryunosuke would Takeru, and just Chiaki would Kotaha.
Which is the one they actually did for Samurai, for better or worse. So, yeah.
No, they did Antonio and Jaden.
God.
Oh, and they did Lauren and Jaden.
I was going to say, yes, incestuous.
Yeah, they did Lauren and Jaden, and then they did Laura and Kevin.
No one wants to see that.
No one wants
to. Wait, does that mean people actually want to see Laura? Nope.
They just have the same last name, guys. Is that because they're actually related? Come on now. Wait, are they actually related? I thought he was doing the whole shadow thing.
In Samurai, yes, they are siblings.
Oh,
Jinkanger, they were part of the... Jinkanger, they were part of the same clan, but not directly related.
They were like
until she adopted him.
Yeah, they were like second cousins, yeah, until she adopted him.
They're not cousins. I don't think he's even a member of the family.
He wasn't. He was just given the name. Yeah, puppet. He was just a shadow puppet.
Well, I thought his father was like, part of the...
No, like, his dad was, like, a part of, like, what mentor, like, what is it? I can't think of his name, the actual Japanese...
Still G.
Yeah, it was still G in Japan, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was, because he was a part of, like, what G was. He was one of those... He wasn't a Kokoro. He was actually at the level of where he was, like,
he
you
was
know...
He was, like, a vassal.
He was, like, a retainer slash vassal, in a sense, where he wasn't a Shinkenger himself. He was just allowed to keep regular clothes or whatever, because he was that close to the... To the family,
was,
in a sense.
What's it called? He had a lot of Mojikara. I don't know why he qualified.
Well, hey, we can say that Love and Toku is not as complicated as Gundam Build Fighters try, and that's a fact.
Yeah, it kind of is, because, I mean, like, that's the problem when it comes to, you know, just relationships. Like, it's either it's there, it's not there. It's just for fans to, like, have fun with, I think. I think sometimes maybe that's why it's intended.
I think people take it too far sometimes, but honestly, at the end of the day... Our current ships are Lucky and Garu, Lucky and Tsurugi and everybody.
Oh, we got Raptor
Raptor and Spada. Raptor and Tsurugi. Raptor and Lucky. Because Raptor had that whole fascination where it was like a whole bunch of them proposing to her.
Yeah.
Stinger and Champ.
Stinger and Champ. The kid had a crush on Stinger.
It's more of a brother thing. I don't think it's more of a crush. I think he's an older brother.
There's Naga and Balance.
Well, of course. Then there's there's
Hammy with Naga, Hammy and Lucky.
Show doesn't get anybody.
Because he needs to be rolled into the grave like he told Tsurugi to do it, and then Tsurugi like slowly looked around.
Build next. It's starting.
Oh, no, the stream. All right, you know what that means? Since we talked about the relationships and we have to go watch an awesome new stream, you know what time it is? Time to give your plugs! Visible Ninja!
Visible Ninja Zero on Twitter.
All right.
Just go.
Sound out, go!
Sound out 12 on everything and anything. Hit me up, wine bottles.
All right, Project,
ready,
you go.
Go!
Project One on Instagram, Project RDM on Twitter.
All right, I'm Wheelchair21 on Facebook, Twitter, and freaking YouTube. On Instagram, I'm Taja underscore Doyle. However, for Hero Club, you can check us out in the outro. This Rush thing is all because of freaking goddamn Gundam and their new Build Fighter series. But nevertheless, talk to us about what your favorite relationship is in Tokusatsu. What your favorite ship should have been that could never happen. And don't just make up a ship to make up a ship to start shit. Because I know there's people out there who will do it. Mucha, when you listen to this podcast. Anyways, we'll see you all.
And the Orion ship.
Yes, but that's her uncle. Nevertheless, we will see you all next time.
On Dragon Ball Z.
Hey, it's Wheelchair21, and thanks again for listening to an all-new episode of Los Ingobernables de Tokusatsu. If you want to hear more content or see more content from the Hero Club YouTube channel, we're going to need you to subscribe, like, comment with some feedback, and share this channel with a friend. We also would like you to check out our website, hero-club.com, and follow us on various social media outlets just by looking up Hero Club for Life, as well as the stores you see are where we shop. Anyways, thanks again, and we'll see you all next time.